and for what you will continue to be. We thank you for your church is marching on, and the gate of hell cannot, will not, and will never prevail against it. We thank you, God, for where you picked us as a church, as a little parish under an area, and then it is now a provincial headquarter. I want to say it has always been you. We thank you for so many lives that has been transformed through this parish. Father, I want to thank you for so many parishes that has been planted through this parish. We give you praise, we give you glory. Father, please accept our thanks in the name of Jesus. Father, as we go into your word, speak to us in the name of Jesus. Let the entrance of your word bring light, and let it bring life unto us in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. I've been asked to talk on positioning for divine visitation. Positioning for divine visitation. And as I'm going to be talking, I'm going to be sharing life testimony, you know, that pertains to us and what God has been doing for us. Let me also start by saying, when we got to Scotland, to God be the glory, before we got to Scotland, I traveled or relocated to the United Kingdom. And I've been doing ministry all my life. Like my mom would say, you know, maybe from when I started to talk, I've been in either choir or anything. We used to live in the church. We used to live in the church at the headquarter, Ebutemeta. And no matter the program that was going on, they said, as little as I was, I would put on my clothes and would say, I'm part of the program. Any program, whether it is marriage, whether it is whatever, I will be there. So I've always been, you know, and later on, I started to grow. I gave my life to Jesus. And, you know, I believe I've been doing ministry all my life. And therefore, I told myself, and I told God, I said, now that I'm going to the UK, people have been going to the United Kingdom to make pounds. It's time for me to also go and make pounds. I want to put a stop to ministry. At least I want it to, you know, be on the burner, you know, just something like a leave or sabbatical. I just, let me also make money. I mean, you know. And then that was my plan. I didn't tell my wife. That was the plan I had. And I said, God, please just allow me. The merciful God showed forth. And when you move to the United Kingdom, there are some things you get easily. For example, there's something called NI, National Insurance. Even people that have not relocated to the United Kingdom, they get it easily. It come to my time, probably because of what I said. First week, no NI. Second week, no NI. I started applying for jobs. For people who knew me, when I was in Nigeria, I was a banker. And then I started my own business. And I was, you know, to God be the glory, I was doing well. Even in South Africa, I was doing business to support the ministry. So I said, now let me also earn some pounds. But I got to the United Kingdom, applied to all jobs, and nobody was ready to take me. I said, what is wrong with me? But I remember I applied for a particular job. And they were so excited when they saw my CV. They were so excited about me. And they said they were going to give me the job. As at 2006, I was going to be earning something close to £100,000 per annum. 2006. So I was so excited. I said, God, thank you. And I got on the train going back home. Immediately I got off the train, I got a call. And they said, Mr. Adelbich. That's how they called me, Adelbich. They can't call Adelbich, so they called me anyhow. They said, Mr. Adelbich, we're so sorry. We're not going to be taking you on. I was devastated. I got back home and I went on my knees and I cried. I said, Lord, it was much easier for me to get jobs in Nigeria. Why is my own, even ordinary NI? Then I heard a voice. You want to be on your own. You want to do your own thing. Go ahead. And I said, Lord, I'm sorry. Because I remember the day I got to England, the second day of June 2006, a pastor has been talking to me. He said he wanted me to plant a parish. I said, no, forget about parish. I'm not doing any ministry. I want to make money. So I started praying. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. What I've said, I said, I don't want to do your own. I want to do my own. I'm sorry. I'm changing. Whatever you ask me to do, I will do. I called the pastor. I said, Pastor, I'm ready to go full time. I will do whatever you ask me to do. Guess what? The second day, around 9 a.m., I got a call from the office where they do the NI. They said, your NI is ready. They said, your NI is ready. So, what has delayed it? I delayed it. Some of the jobs that I applied to, some of them started calling me. And they said, oh, you can come and have the job. But because of the covenant I had with God, I said, no, I am going to do what you ask me to do. Positioning for divine visitation. James chapter 4, verse 8. James chapter 4, verse 8. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. When we talk about divine visitation, we are referring to God intervening in a situation. That is God's presence in intervening in human affairs. And when we talk about divine, of course we know divine means God is involved. And when we talk about visitation, that is God getting involved in that situation. So when we talk about positioning for divine visitation, it means making yourself available for God to intervene in your situation. Making yourself available, what do we need to do to making ourselves, you know, ready in our situation, getting ourselves in a position that God will look at us and say, yes, my son, I will send you. Just like Isaiah said, I'm here, Lord, send me wherever. And I remember that evening when I prayed, I said, Lord, wherever you send me. I didn't know God was going to be sending me to Scotland. I said, wherever you're going to be sending me to, I'm ready, Lord, send me. No wonder, within 2 months, I was sent to Scotland to start the Open Heavens in 5. That's a long testimony. Somebody asked me to write a story, a book about it. I'm still, you know, the Holy Spirit has not asked me to. It's only people asking me to. But, you know, if the Holy Spirit asked me to, one day, you will read about my book. Positioning yourself for divine visitation. What is involved? I'm going to just talk about a few things because, like I said, I'm going to be sharing testimonies along with it. The first thing you need to do to be able to position yourself for God's divine intervention in your life is it has to do with your heart. Your heart, you need to start to cultivate a heart of expectancy. You need to, you know, make up your mind. That song says, I've got my mind made up. If your heart is not in what you want to do, you will only be wasting your time. I remember clearly that evening when I lie down and I said, Lord, my heart is with you. Wherever you want to send me to, I'm ready to go. No wonder when I got to Scotland and many things started to happen. For example, when we planted a church in Scotland, we planted it in a place called Glenrothes. Glenrothes is between Dundee. For some of us that usually say Dundee United. You remember Dundee United? And then you know Edinburgh. Dundee, somebody came to Scotland and said, so is it true that we have Dundee United? It is true, we have Dundee United. We have Dundee United and Dundee United Football Club. Okay? So, Glenrothes is equivalent between Edinburgh and Dundee. And for 7 years, the normal attendance was 6 adults and 4 children. For 7 years. But thank God, because God has prepared my heart for what was going to be happening. I was, thank God for my wife and thank God for my children. I'm sure there were times when my children will have been saying to themselves, Daddy, we've heard enough of your preaching. For 7 years, 6 adults and 4 children. Out of the 4 children, 2 are mine. And out of these 6 adults, 2 were retired. I was a full-time pastor. My wife was working. One other person was working. And the other person was a nursing mother. So, practically, only 2 people were working. I mean, full-time employment. But do you know, because the Lord has prepared us, the heart was ready, the heart of expectancy was there. God was doing great things. Within those 7 years, we may not have congregation, but do you know, almost everything that was done in that town, they always come to Pastor Joseph. They know me as Pastor Joseph. We were so involved in the community. Whatever God asked us to do, we were just doing it. We may not have, you know, congregation, but we had congregation among the people. So God be the, I don't know, Mommy Ogunsanwo is not around. She visited us at one point in time. She saw the number of people. Hallelujah. If there is no act of expectancy, you're not expecting God to do something, you may not be positioned for that divine visitation. When you go through the scripture, Abraham and Sarah, Anna, Mary, Peter and John, for example, Peter and John, when they got to the beautiful gate, they knew something will happen. That was why they helped the man to stand up. Because they had that expectancy. Their heart was fixed on the Lord Jesus. Maybe you are just coming to church. Well, it's just a religious activity. That cannot position you for divine positioning, divine visitation. When we read the book of Mark, chapter 5, verse 25 to 34. Mark chapter 5, 25 to 34. It talks about the story of the woman with the issue of blood. Before this woman left the house, she made up her mind. In fact, I believe she had a healing even before she left the house. Why? She said, if I can only touch the hem of his garments. He knew. She was expectant. She was looking forward to sharing testimony. To God be the glory. We have so many testimonies to share in Scotland. To God be the glory. But it was because God prepared our heart to be with expectancy. One of the things the Lord did for us with six adults and four children was that one Sunday we were having our service just like this, and the word of the Lord came and said, I'm going to give you a building. As at that time, to God be the glory, even though we were six adults and four children, do you know within that period, within 1 year that we got to Scotland, miraculously, God made available for us to have a mortgage, to have a house of our own. Of course, it's not like Nigeria. You take a mortgage and then you pay it over time. When they gave us the mortgage, how did it happen? After Sunday, the pastor, Esther, was the choir mistress. Enoch was the projector guy. My wife was teaching the children and also part of the congregation. So the little offering we collected, I took it to the bank to go and pay, because I was also the treasurer. I was the admin. Pastor, you are enjoying. I was the admin. I was the usher. I was the almost everything. So we collected the offering. I went to pay into the bank. And the person collecting the money from me said, how come you don't have mortgage with us? It is the name of the bank is Halifax. How come you don't have a mortgage with us? I said, well, even if I apply, you won't give me. She said, well, you can give us a try. She made an appointment for us. I got home, I told my wife. My wife said, you have come with this, your wonders. How did you get this? I said, well, I was just paying in the offerings when this woman said, I should come for an appointment, and we have to go together. So we went, and by the time we came out of that meeting, we came out with a mortgage promise. Now, what is the testimony in it? We were only in the United Kingdom for 1 year. Our visa was going to run out within 2 years. They don't normally give mortgages to people with 2 years visa. My aunt that took me in when I got to England said she was in the United Kingdom for more than 10 years before she bought her first house. It took us less than 1 year. Why? Because God, in his own mercy, prepared us with a heart of expectancy. And therefore, what took people 10 years, 5 years, 15 years to achieve, we did it within 1 year. And where I'm also going is that with the six adults and four children, we were able to buy a church building without paying mortgage. We bought it cash. Why? Because God has prepared us. It is not just church as usual. It was with an expectancy. We knew God was in this because he asked me not. I applied for so many jobs. Sometimes they will call me. I will tell them I'm a pastor. I can't work on Sunday. They will say, sorry, if you can't work on Sunday, we can't give you the job. But with six adults, and I've told you, two were retired. One is a full-time pastor. One is a nursing mother. Only two was working. We bought a building worth £150,000 without taking mortgage. When God intervenes in your situation, it is not man. But you have to be in that position where God can say, yes, let me move on your behalf. The woman with the issue of blood, before leaving the house, she already made up her mind. She had an expectancy. I ask you today, what are you expecting? Are you just coming to church for coming's sake? Are you just doing things well? If I don't come, pastor will send follow-up people to follow me up. Is that the reason why? Or you are coming to have an impactful word of God, to have a divine visitation in your life. Number two, we need to pursue intimacy through prayer and worship. We need to, you want to be intimate with God. Just beyond just church service. Just beyond I'm going from one program or the other. It has to be an intimate relationship with God. When God was talking about Moses, God said, he is my servant. I speak to him mouth to mouth. Can God speak of you in that intimacy relationship? The Bible passage we read said we need to draw to God and he will draw to us. Are you pursuing to be intimate with God? Or all you are just doing is, well, we have pastors who can pray for me. As long as they are praying. They will be praying, but what about you? You can be the source of God's power if you are intimate with God. And that can only be through prayer and through worship. Psalm 27, verse 4. The Bible says, one thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell. There are many Christians today. People ask me, they say, there are so many Christians in Nigeria. We hear of so many miracles in Nigeria, but why is Nigeria not changing? Can I tell you the truth? It's because of you. It's because of me. Individually. What are we doing? Pastor was contributing to the Sunday school. He was talking about governance. It starts with you. It starts with me. All programs are good. All the beautiful programs are good. But do you have intimate relationship with God? Many on Sunday like this, the whole street is empty. People are in one church or the other. But all these people, once they get out of church, do they have that intimacy with God? No wonder many of us are not experiencing that divine visitation that we have always been craving for. Intimacy. You need to develop that intimacy with God. You need to not only develop it, pursue it with everything that is within you. You want to be intimate with God. You want to be able to talk with him. David said, one thing I ask, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. To do what? To gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. Have you prioritized your intimacy with God? Or you are just doing the motions? We need to pursue this for us to be positioned for that divine visitation that we all have been praying for. Hallelujah. Number three, we need to embrace obedience and total surrender. Obedience and total surrender. Divine visitation often follows obedience and surrender to God's will. The moment I said, "Lord, whatever you ask me to do, I will do," things started to move. Do you know, I'm still trying to find out what stopped my NI. It took me almost 2 months to get NI. When people come to the UK, it takes them maximum 2 days, 3 days. But for Ibukun, because Ibukun wanted to do his own thing, it took almost 2-3 months. Total obedience and surrendering. If you totally obey and surrender to God's will, your divine visitation will be sooner than you expect. In Jesus' name. One of the things I noted down as part of the testimony, when we were bidding to buy is a Church of Scotland that we bought, to God be the glory. When we were bidding to buy the building, we went to look at the building, myself and my wife. And when I saw it, I said, "Wow, this is beautiful." And I told the elder of the church, you know, it was in the night, I said, "Please, can we pray?" And I said, "You know, we are used to holding hands. I hope we still hold hands in Nigeria." Amen. So I asked my wife and the elder, two of them, we held hands and I prayed, and the elder of the Church of Scotland was saying amen to my prayer. That was when I knew God has given us that building. Do you know it was the same elder who went to write an independent report about us? He said, because when we bidded for 150. Other people were bidding 600, 800, and all of that. Our bid was the lowest. This man wrote an independent report and said, "I know this church. I have researched them. RCCG is a good church that God is going to be using as a revival catalyst in our country, and I desire that they will give it to this church." We met him for the first time when we prayed together. But when God has decided to intervene in your situation, no matter the bidding, you will get it. And of course, we got it. We prayed, and then before we put in the amount, I was praying. I said, "Lord, how much should we put in?" And I told my wife, I said, "I felt the Holy Spirit told me to put in 150. Even my wife said, "Ah." The building, when they did the evaluation, currently we're paying insurance premium on it for £2.5 million. That's the insurance we are paying. And we bought it for 150. So I told my wife, I said, "Well, that's what I heard the Holy Spirit. Total obedience. I'm going to do that." I called the solicitor and I said, she said, "How much are you going to bid?" I said, 150. She said, "You guys are not serious. Are you doing speculative bidding or you are serious at all?" I said, "That is what my commander-in-chief asked me to put down." She said, "You are not serious." I said, before you begin to abuse me, that 150 include VAT and all taxes. She said, now I know you are crazy. But because the Lord have said it. Do you know, after they gave us the building, they took it from us. They said, we are not serious because we didn't have enough money to pay the... They took it away from us. They said we should bid again. We bid it again. They still gave it to us. To God be the glory. In the last 11 years, that is where we have been worshiping. When you read Luke chapter 1 verse 38, Luke chapter 1 verse 38, Mary said, may your word to me be fulfilled. I am the Lord's servant. Are you living a life of obedience and total surrender? Or you are just doing your own thing by your own self? You know, sometimes when God asks you to do something, it doesn't look okay. How does it look okay? God told Abraham, take your everything and go to the airport and then go to a country where I will show you. And Abraham got to the airport, Lagos Murtala Mohammed Airport, and said, can I buy a ticket? They said, where are you going? Just give me a ticket. Don't you think they will call social worker? I don't know if they do that here. And say, this man, is he crazy? We said, where are you going? Just give me a ticket. I want to be on the plane. It looks stupid, but today we are all Abraham's seed. Why? Because he obeyed. Are you living a life of obedience? Are you trusting the Lord? Mary said, I am the Lord's servant. Let your word be fulfilled in my life. Is that the same thing you are doing? Let me round up. Number four, we need to be walking in faith and boldness. We need to be walking in faith and boldness. Like I said, sometimes faith can look stupid. When God told that the Geo that he should move to the redemption camp, even the elders at that time, they said, they got a place somewhere in a Jew area, you know, which was looking very good, very, you know, but Daddy Geo said, God said we should go there. Does it look okay? All the people that say it doesn't look okay, what are they doing now? Many of them are coming to build houses in Redemption City of God. Sometimes the things of God, you need that boldness. And thank God for Daddy Geo. He stood by it. And I also jotted it down. When we were going to buy our own building, even the central office of our own central office in the UK, they said, even if we buy this building for you, we will be over-laboring you. You can't maintain it. Somebody wrote an independent report from the central office and said, hey, peradventure this man and this woman, they are walking in faith, just like Daddy Geo walked in faith in 1983 and went to a place, a bush, that we now call Redemption City. Why don't we give them, at least listen to them? Even the authority that was sending us, they did not believe in us. But thank God, I remember I called my dad. My dad said, whatsoever is of the Lord will stand. And that was the word I held on to. Dad told me, he said, tell your members, at that time, six adults. My dad said, tell them, don't pray for anything again. Don't ask God for anything. Just start thanking God, because the Lord said he will do it, and he will do it. We started praising God. We started doing everything apart from asking God, because we knew it has been done. And we took that step of faith. We took that step of faith. Let me share the last testimony before I close. When we're about to buy the building, I told you, when we bid it the first time, they gave it to us, they collected it back because we needed 15,000 pounds as a down deposit. We didn't have it. The maximum we had in our account was less than 500 pounds. And then we bid it again. So they gave it to us again. And then one member of the congregation, himself and his wife, he came to me, he said, myself and my wife, we've been praying. We want to buy a house. And I know the church need money. We have saved up about 10,000 so that we can pay use for our deposits. We are willing to borrow it to the church, to lend it to the church. And the church can pay us at any time. Guess what? I said, God bless you. Where have you been? Bring the money. Bring the money. That evening, somebody else called me. One of my friends is a medical doctor. He called me from London. He said, as I was about to enter my house, I was turning the key. The Holy Spirit said, everything in your bank account, go and give it to Joseph. He said, and I have to obey. That's why I'm calling you. Can you give me the church account? I gave him the church account. He gave us the exact money that is needed to complete 15,000. You need to walk in faith. Let me tell you, this is not magic. It is not, you know, somebody try. This is reality. Anytime you are in England, please call me, come and visit, and you will see the glory of the Lord. Where am I going with that testimony? This guy gave us 10,000, lend it to the church. By the time we collected all the money God provided, we paid him back. Within 2 months that we paid him back, the banks that have been refusing him mortgage, they gave him mortgage. To God be the glory, he's in his second house now. He has bought a second house. We need to walk in faith if you want to experience divine visitation. When you read Acts chapter 12, verse 1 to 17, the children of God were praying that Peter would be released. But do you know, when Peter was miraculously released and he got to the door, they didn't want to open. It took a little girl to say, it is Peter. It is Peter. That little girl can be you today. We need to walk in faith. Don't just pray. You need to pray with expectation. Let me close by saying this. Maybe you are here. You've been coming to church or you've been going to different churches, but you have never given your life to Jesus. Guess what? There's no way. The best you can do is to say you are being stupid. Stop being stupid and start acting in faith. Because if you don't know who we are talking about, if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, there's no way you can ask for intimacy. The first intimacy you can ask for today is, Lord Jesus, save me. I want to be your child. Forgive me of all my sins. Give me your Holy Spirit. Let me also begin to walk in faith and in boldness. And if you are here, you have given your life to Jesus, and you are still waiting for divine visitation, the question is, have you positioned yourself for divine visitation? Shall we pray? What is it going to be for you? Oh, they are saying it. There's no proof. We are proof of God's work. What is it going to be for you today? You can ask people to pray for you. You can even pay for them to pray for you. But you don't need to. You can also have that intimacy with God. You can start with that heart of expectancy. But when that heart is not changed, it will only expect for endless ages. You can start your journey today for a heart of expectancy by giving your heart to Jesus. Is there anyone who wants to say, yes, I want to come to you, Lord. I want to give my heart to you. I want to start a journey with you, a journey of intimacy. You want me to pray with you? You want the pastorate to pray with you? You can start that by faith, by only just raising your hand or standing wherever you are and say, Lord Jesus, this is not a story. This is a reality testimony that this one is talking about. This one, I've tasted the Lord. I also want to taste the Lord. For the rest of us, you can pray and say, Lord, my heart, search my heart, search my heart, search my heart, oh God. I've not been 100% loyal to you, but today I want to change that. My faith is not probably enough, but Lord, I cry unto you, help my faith. Build up my faith, oh God. I want to look up unto you with boldness and say, I am your child. I want to be a living testimony to the glory of God the Father, to the glory of God the Son, to the glory of God the Holy Spirit. But that journey has to start from the day you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Is there anyone who wants us to pray? Father, I want to thank you even for this one standing and saying they want to start a journey to be positioned for your divine visitation. Father, you know each and every one. We ask, oh God, according to your word, you said if anyone come to you, you will in no wise cast out. Father, I pray, as this one once have cried out unto you, please, Lord, hear them. Cleanse them. Starting from today, give them a brand new life and gift them the gift of the Holy Spirit in the name of Jesus. That as they walk out of this place, Father, I pray, they will not be the same person that came into this sanctuary in the name of Jesus. And when you shall come, Lord, every one of us, including these ones that are giving their hearts to you today, Father, count us worthy to reign with you in the name of Jesus. And Father, I pray concerning every one of us, we're looking up unto you for one divine visitation, for one divine intervention or the other. Father, we pray, may we be positioned for it. In the name of Jesus. According to your word, you said the expectation of the righteous will not be cut short. Our expectation is on you, oh God. Don't let us be disappointed. In the name of Jesus. Father, in every area of our lives that we are exercising unbelief, today will mark an end to unbelief. In the name of Jesus. We begin to exercise in faith and in boldness in the name of Jesus. Thank you because you have done it. Blessed be your name forever. In Jesus' name we pray.